हेलो एवरीवन, आई एम सोबी जैन, मेंबर ऑफ कॉप्स आईआईटी बीएचयू। वी आर बैक विद अनदर सीरीज एंड दिस टाइम द टॉपिक इज डायनेमिक प्रोग्रामिंग। सो व्हाट इज डायनेमिक प्रोग्रामिंग? इट इज बेसिकली एन एल्गोरिथमिक टेक्निक दैट वी यूज टू सॉल्व अ प्रॉब्लम बाय ब्रेकिंग डाउन इंटू मल्टीपल सब प्रॉब्लम्स। दैट इज इफ वी आर गिवन अ प्रॉब्लम वी कैन सॉल्व इट यूजिंग ब्रूट फोर्स टेक्निक्स और सम अदर टेक्निक्स, बट वी वॉन्ट टू ऑप्टिमाइज इट, वी वॉन्ट टू रिड्यूस द टाइम कॉम्प्लेक्सिटी, सो वी यूज दिस टेक्निक कॉल्ड डायनेमिक प्रोग्रामिंग। वी कैन यूज दिस टेक्निक वेन वी नो दैट द ऑप्टिमल सोल्यूशंस ऑफ द सब प्रॉब्लम्स विल कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू द फाइनल आंसर। प्लस सिंस वी आर यूजिंग द सब प्रॉब्लम्स टू कैलकुलेट द आंसर फॉर आर फाइनल प्रॉब्लम, we keep on storing the answers for these sub problems so that we don't have to recompute them again and we can save time. Now we'll move to characteristics of DP. Since when we are thinking of applying DP to some problem, we must know that what all conditions should that problem fulfill so that we can apply DP on it. So first is optimal substructure and the other is overlapping subproblems. So first we'll start with optimal substructure. So all of you might be familiar with the Fibonacci series, which has this recursive relation, that is Fibonacci of the nth term is equal to the summation of the previous two terms. So here 0 and 1, that is the 0th and the first element we have as our base case. Then if we want to calculate Fibonacci of 2, we will get 0 plus 1, that is the sum of the previous two elements to get our next element. Similarly, if we want to calculate the third element, then we'll calculate the sum of the first and the second element, and 1 plus 1 we get 2. So this was the introduction to the Fibonacci series if some of you don't know about this. Then what do we mean by optimal substructure? So from the explanation of this Fibonacci series, we can conclude that while calculating the Fibonacci for the nth number, we divided this problem into two subproblems, that is Fibonacci of n minus 1 and Fibonacci of n minus 2. Basically, it had some structure that the final subproblem, which is calculating the value of n, next is overlapping subproblems. So suppose we want to calculate the value of Fibonacci 5. Since Fibonacci of n is Fibonacci of n minus 1 plus n minus 2. So n minus 1 will be 4 and n minus 2 is going to be 3. So now our problem has been divided into two subproblems. Now we'll recursively solve all these subproblems. So now moving on to this Fibonacci of 4, it will be again divided into two other subproblems, that is of 4 minus 1, 3 and 4 minus 2, 2. So we'll keep on dividing these subproblems until we reach the base case, that is Fibonacci of 1 and Fibonacci of 0, because we already know their values, that Fibonacci of 1 is 1 and Fibonacci of 0 is 0. So as you can observe that while we were calculating the value of Fibonacci of 5, this value of calculating Fibonacci of 3, it was repeated twice in this tree also and in this particular tree also while calculating the value of Fibonacci of 4. This is what we mean by overlapping subproblems. That is, we are trying to calculate the value of the same problem again and again. So when this type of case arises, we can use DP to optimize our problem. So next, there are basically two methods to solve DP questions. One is the top-down approach and another is the bottom-up approach. Top-down is also known as memoization. A bottom-up approach is also known by tabulation. So first we'll start by top-down approach. So as the name suggests, we move from top to bottom for calculating our problem. So what will we call as top? Top will be considered as the final value of our problem, what we want to output as the answer. And if we want to calculate the value of Fibonacci of 5, we'll first start by finding the answer of Fibonacci of 5. Then since we know that Fibonacci of nth number is equal to the summation of Fibonacci of n minus 1 and n minus 2 number, and currently we don't know what is the value of Fibonacci of 4 and Fibonacci of 3. So we'll again move to their subproblems and find the values until we reach the base case. And what do we mean by memoization? Since we have to save time and we don't want to calculate these subproblems, for example, this Fibonacci of 3. So we keep on storing the answers for the sub problems so that when we encounter these sub problems again while solving the problem, we can just use the stored value and save our time. Here is a pseudocode for the top-down approach. So as I told, if we want to calculate the value of nth Fibonacci number, we started with n. N can be any number. Then these are the base cases, as already mentioned, that Fibonacci of 0th position is 0 and 1 is 1. This is our case where we are reusing our stored values. That is, if we have already calculated the value of nth Fibonacci number, then we return that whatever we have stored. We are not going to calculate it again and again. And this is finally our DP relation. That is, value of nth Fibonacci number is the sum of n minus 1 and n minus 2 number. And at the same time, we are storing it in DP of n also. So talking about the time complexity and space complexity for top-down approach. So as seen in the pseudocode, we declared an array that was used for memoization. That is, if we want to calculate the nth Fibonacci number, it will require us to declare an array which should have at least n spaces to store all these numbers in order to save the time. And since we are using recursion, so there will also be a stack memory. That is, first we started with calculating the value of Fibonacci of 5. Then we moved down to calculate the Fibonacci of 3 and 4. So since we are not, initially we were not having the values of 3 and 4. So first into the stack we put down 5. Then since we didn't have the values for 4 and 3, so we put down 4 and 3. So at max, the height of the stack is going to be order of n. So total we have this array and this stack memory, both of order of n. So finally, the space complexity will be O of n. Now looking at the time complexity, here we can see that while calculating the value of nth Fibonacci number, we need to calculate the values of n minus 1, n minus 2, up to the second Fibonacci number, because we already know the values of 0 and 1. Here C is a constant, which is the constant time we require to find the values of these numbers. So continuing till here, finally we will by doing n minus 1, n minus 2 till n minus k, finally we'll reach 0. And here we are getting n times the constant time which we are taking to calculate these n numbers. So t of 0 is going to be 1, because we already know the answer of 0th Fibonacci number. And 1 plus n times this constant, we are going to get the order of O of n. Finally, it didn't use DP, so it would have been an exponential time problem. And we finally managed to reduce it to a linear time problem. Now, seeing the bottom-up approach, which is also called as tabulation. So as the name suggests, we are moving from the bottom. That is, we are moving from the base cases and then we'll move to the final problem. It is just opposite of the top-down approach. So as here it is written, we start by solving the related sub-problems until we manage to build the final result. So if we want to calculate the value of Fibonacci of 5, we know the values of 0 and 1. So we'll add 0 and 1 to get our second Fibonacci number. Then we already know the value of 1. Then we'll add the first and second to get the third Fibonacci number. Then we'll add third and fourth to get the fourth Fibonacci number. And finally, our answer. So in this way, we use these base cases and the related sub-problems to achieve our final answer. It will be more clear after seeing its pseudocode. So it is basically a single for loop and iterative approach. Here we have declared an array, initializing the base cases then. And as you can observe, we are moving bottom to top. So we initially had 0 and 1, then we started off with 2. So DP of 2 was DP of 1 plus DP of 0. Next, our loop will move to I equal to 3. Then we'll iteratively we'll calculate these values up to n. So we use the base cases, the sub problems which we had, and manage to get our final answer. Now seeing it, space and time complexity. So for space complexity, we here use just an array that will be order of n definitely. But one thing we can note is, since we are iteratively calculating the values of the nth Fibonacci, so what you need to think is that what do you need while calculating the value of nth Fibonacci? That is only the n minus 1th and the n minus 2 positions. We do not need the n minus 3, n minus 4 or whatever the previously calculated values were. So we can just take two variables and keep on changing their values such that they store the n minus 1 and n minus 2 positions. So its space complexity can be reduced to order of 1. Now looking at the time complexity, as it is very clear since here it is a single for loop which is moving from I equal to 2 up to n. So here also the time complexity is order of n. Summing up, the time complexity in both the top down and the bottom up approaches is order of n. So this was a brief introduction. Now I'll share a problem which will give you more insights about DP, like in what kind of problems and in what manner you can use to optimize your solutions. So the name of the problem is coin change problem. So the problem states that we are given n cents or n rupees and there are infinite supply of coins of different denominations. For example, we are having C1, C2 up to CM coins and these coins will have some value. Suppose it is a 2 rupee coin or 5 rupee coin and we are having infinite supply of these coins. That is, the number of coins are not limited. So what do we need to find is, suppose someone is giving us this $4 or 4 rupee, so we have to give the changes for these 4 rupees. That is, we have to use these coins in such a manner they sum up to this given number of cents. So in this example, we have n equal to 4 and the coins which we have are 1 rupee, 2 rupee and 3 rupee coins. Mentioning again, we have infinite supply of these coins. So here are some of the, actually these are all the different ways in which we can represent the 4 in terms of 1, 2 and 3. So either we can use 4 1 rupee coins or 2 1 rupee and 1 2 rupee coin, or it can be 2 2 rupees coins, and the last option is we can use a 1 rupee coin and a 3 rupee coin. So obviously if you start thinking that how can you solve these problems, what are the different ways in which you can give these changes, so there definitely exists a brute force solution. You can exhaust all the different types of subsets of these coins which will exist and then choose from them what all will give you the summation of 4, but it is definitely going to be really time consuming. So now let us see how we can apply DP to this problem. So as mentioned earlier, first of all, what do we need to check is the two conditions, that is optimal substructure and overlapping subproblems, before we apply DP to any question. So talking about optimal substructure, suppose we have a set of our solutions, that is I'm calling this as the set of my solutions. So we can divide these solutions into two different parts. So one part will be those solutions which do not contain the CMth coin, and another part will be those solutions which contain at least one mth coin. Suppose here m is 1. So what I'm saying is we can divide our solutions into two different parts. First will be those solutions which do not contain the 1 rupee coin, that is this, and the solutions which contain at least 1 rupee coin, that is these three. We basically got a structure that how our solutions can be divided. So suppose we have this function func and the parameters passed are n, that is the total number of cents we have, m the number of different coins we have, and the array of the coins, the denominations, and this function is going to return us the number of solutions. We have divided our solutions into two parts, first which will not have the mth coin. So this term depicts all those solutions which do not have the mth coin, because here since we have used m minus 1, that is the coin which was there on the mth position, we have not taken that coin. Suppose we iteratively move from 0 to 1 to up to the mth coin, so we have choices whether to take that coin or not to take that coin. This term represents that we haven't taken our mth coin, plus the second term, that those solutions have at least one mth coin, that is we are picking up the mth coin, and here we have used m. And what does this term represent? N minus cm. Since we are picking up the mth coin, so, and this is going to give our answer. So that means whatever value of coins we had plus the mth coin should give us n. So suppose I had 4 cents and I already have 2 rupees. Now if I want to make those 2 rupees to total to 4 rupees, so what I will do is n is 4 and 4 minus 2 we will take. So that the remaining 2 rupee coins which we are using now, that will add up to give the summation 4. So this shows that the problem which I just started now, it has the optimal substructure. Now checking the second condition of overlapping subproblem. So again, here this is our function 1, 2 and 3. These numbers which are enclosed in curly braces, these are the different denominations which I have of the coins, comma 4. 4 is the total number of cents which we have, for which we need to get the changes. So on right side, we are moving as whatever first element we have in these curly braces. We are not picking up that coin. While if we move left, that shows that we are picking up that coin. So if we move left, so first of all, we have 1. Since I picked up 1, that is, now I have 1 rupees with me. So what am I left with is n equal to 3. Similarly, if I move again left, that is, I'm again picking up the 1 rupee coin. So I'll be left with n equal to 2. And in case I move right, that is, I don't pick up the 1 rupee coin. So I'll be left with the denominations 2 and 3. And since I didn't pick up any coin, so n is not going to change. As you can see, n was 3 here. Similarly, and was 3 here. So if we build this tree kind of structure, we will see that these circles which are encircled in the same color, we are calculating these values again and again. So this shows the property of overlapping subproblems, and it is mentioned here also. You can pause the video and check this tree again if you are having any confusion. As seen, that both the conditions which were necessary to apply DP to the problem have been fulfilled. Now seeing the code of this coin change problem, first I'll declare the array of coins, see, and I had 1, 2, 3 rupee denomination coins. Next, I had n equal to 4. Now I'll declare my function here. I'll pass the number of cents which I have, the number of coins, and the different denominations which I had. So first of all, we need to mention the base cases, what all we had. If we have n equal to 0, then there will be one solution, that is not to include any coin. So we'll return 1. Next, if n is equal to 0, that is what all cases that we use, what all coins that we took, those are exceeding the limit of n. So we will return 0. That is no solution exists. Now we have one more condition to check. That is, if the position of the coin we are accessing is less than 0, that is, we have exhausted all the array of coins, and if the value of n is greater than or equal to 1. So what does this show? That we have seen all the coins but kept on iterating, and now we have no coins to choose, but still we didn't manage to get the total as n. So here we are not getting any solution, so we will return 0. Now finally, coming to the recursive relation, as this problem, it was divided into two sub problems. That is, first, we are not going to pick up this mth coin. That is, since we are not picking up the coin, so the total number of cents which we have to calculate will remain the same, and this will be m minus 1 because we didn't pick up the mth coin, and the array of coins plus the second sub problem, that is, we are picking up this mth coin. Since we are picking up this mth coin, so the last sum which we are going to use is n minus c of m, comma, we use this mth coin and the array of coins. Now we will finally call this function. So n is 4. Next here, we'll take m as 2 because we are iterating from the back. That is, this will be the second position, so we are taking m as 2 and the array of coins. So let's check the answer for this. So we got the answer as 4. As we saw here, that we had 4 different cases to represent this to get change for the 4 cents. So I hope you liked the video. So please like and share and subscribe to our YouTube channel for further updates and more videos like this. Thank you.